us drink and be merry, all out of one glass. Let us drink and be merry. Ahoy, yes, scalawags and landlubbers. Welcome to this week's episode of Miniature Mythos, where we'll be sailing the treacherous seas of pirate lore and legend. No, but in all fairness, welcome guys, welcome back to this week's actual episode of Miniature Mythos. I hope everyone can hear me, because this time it's not just instrumental music, it's actually with like the sea shanties. Hello, hello, welcome, welcome, hello everyone. Now, picture this, if you will. A fierce pirate captain, eye patch over one eye, gold hoop earring, a tricorn hat atop his head, filled with schemes of plunder. His scruffy beard drips with salt water as he barks orders across the creaking ship. A cutlass at his side and a parrot on his shoulder. Jolly Roger flaps in the wind on the mast above him, and a map leading to buried treasures is safely tucked away in his belt, waiting to reveal its secrets. A life of adventure, danger, and untold riches on the high seas. That's the pirate life. Or so the tales would have us believe, because there's actually a lot of misconceptions, a lot of myths surrounding pirate life and pirate lore. Like the question that Dark Chasey is now asking, do you know why they had an eye patch? Well, most of the time, because they were wounded. Not a lot of pirates had an eye patch. That is one of those many misconceptions that just goes out there. A lot of people speculated that, well, if they cover one eye, then they have one eye that is accustomed to night. So if they go under the deck, their eye is immediately used to the light. That is one possible explanation. But a lot of people are actually saying, well, apart from having glass eyes or having lost an eye in combat, there is no reason why a pirate have ever had an eye patch. So it's one of those things that not a lot of people actually agree on. But we all know that pirates don't actually had a lot of eye patches. The fact that we know or we think that they had eye patches goes back to the movie Treasure Island in the 50s, where the character of Long John Silver had an eye patch, and he made such a great impression on the people that suddenly everywhere pirates with eye patches would pop up, because it was so iconic. Only the smart ones had eye patches. Really? Why were they smart? I'm feeling this is just a setup for a joke, while I am here, totally serious. I seem to be testing on that blockbuster show, Mythbuster show, I guess. It did help. Yes, of course, it did help if you have, like, an eye covered. It will of course be accustomed to low light. So if you go from the searing sun below decks, yeah, your eye will immediately see a lot better in the dark. But that wasn't, you know, also so very permeated in the maritime scene. Most people apparently just waited a couple seconds and their eyesight would be fine. Also, unlike what we might think, below decks in a ship, there are lanterns there. There is light down there. There are holes in the deck of the ship that would, you know, light up parts of the lower decks. Also, most of the time, if you are a sailor, you are on top of a deck, and you don't have to go downstairs all that often. And if you're below deck, that means your job is below decks, and you quite often just remain below decks. So yeah, the whole eye patch thing, most of the time it's when they lose an eye. There are a lot of theories, like I'm gonna theorycraft a bit more about other stuff during the stream, but there's just a couple of things that Time, Myth, Hollywood have just clouded for us. Hey, Custard Sire! Yar! Ahoy! Welcome in! So yeah, there are actually a lot of misconceptions about it, but we'll get into that later. So, I don't know, what is your perception of pirates? Do you like, I mean, most of us have grown up on the image of, first of all, cartoon pirates, the pirates that have been everywhere, and then of course the Disney series Pirates of the Caribbean, which is a huge series, which is very influential for the image of pirates and everything that has to do with pirates. And a lot of our preconceptions are just based on what those movies have given us, which could be wrong. Let's be honest about it. They are fantastic movies. They're awesome to watch. They're spectacular. But that's where the problem hides. They are a bit spectacular, even in the parts that aren't, you know, mythical tentacle-faced monsters or undead pirates, you know, because of course those are not true. I'm sorry if you believe that, but those things aren't true. Yeah, but even apart from those obviously fantastical elements, there are a lot of things that they just took out of the Hollywood scene and not out of history. There are a lot of things that are actually historically correct, but, you know, like all good things, it's a mix of both. It's very believable, it looks realistic, but just enough so you take all the fantastical things with it. So, so today, as we put the brushes to our miniatures, we'll delve into the world of pirates, privateers, buccaneers, and more. We'll explore myths, unravel legends, and maybe even debunk a few misconceptions that you might have. So grab your grog, find a comfortable perch, and join me for this nautical journey. For who knows what truths we might uncover about these enigmatic figures of history. So let's set sail. And may your course ever be true. Now, as you can see here, I have a couple more miniatures ready this time around than I usually have. So, well, no, that's not true. What grog you fancy? Well, of course, I like the Kraken grog, the rum, which is very tasty. I am sure that a lot of people like the Kraken rum as well. Really feels like a pirate drink with the whole, but for now, sweet bean. Well, just a glass of water, please, because I'm really thirsty. Yes, I got you. No, but I have like these two small miniatures here. One is a pirate woman leaping over a couple of crates. And the other is a pirate clutching a chest, trying to get away or fleeing. So, of course, I'm gonna just put them both on this base and try to create a scene in which one is trying to outrun the other. But for now, I'm not gonna connect them to the base just yet, just so it's easier to actually paint them in all different angles here. So yeah, I'm just seeing that there's like a little bit of fluff here. It's amazing how much detail I get on these cameras so I can actually see how dirty my stuff is. Now, I was suddenly shocked because my girlfriend was suddenly standing behind me. An ambush! So, we are going to start painting the skin on these figurines because, as you know, you have to start somewhere. And skin is a good as place as any. Now, as we think about pirates, we always think about the Golden Age of Piracy. Now, when is the Golden Age of Piracy? That is mostly the late 17th century to early 18th century. If you think about it, you know, late 17th, early 18th century, that is, you know, not a very long period of time, and it isn't. Basically, the Golden Age of Piracy was only a period of about, let's say, 40 years. All the things that made pirates great, all the things that you think about when you hear pirates, treasure hunts, outlaws, battles on the high seas, it only happened in a span of 40 years. Now, that doesn't mean that there isn't more to it and that the build-up hasn't been going on for way longer. No, of course not. Like every good story, there is a start, a middle, and an ending. So, where did it all start with the Golden Age of Piracy? Well, with the European discovery of the Americas, of course. Preceding the Golden Age of Piracy, you had Christopher Columbus, who sailed to the New World, quote-unquote. He opened up the Americas to exploration by the European states. Now, that in itself did not start piracy. There were ships who went that way before that. They just didn't quite know what they were getting into or where they were going. But it was after that, because the European powers started to see profit in the overseas domains, that we got to see the rise of maritime empires. You have states that just make money off the back of colonizing new territories, finding new resources, getting in on the trade as quickly as possible. Everyone has probably heard of the fact that the European states would go to Africa, trade European goods for slaves there, and then they would go to the Americas to offload those slaves and get American goods there. Well, that's basically what started. Every European nation worth its salt with a large enough naval force would try to get in on the game as quickly as possible. And most of all were Spain and Portugal, who had vast quantities of wealth that they wanted to transport overseas. And yeah, that's... If you know your history, you might know that if one country is getting a bit too complacent and too rich, other countries don't tend to like that. Oops, drop them. Sure, why don't you? So, the moment that Spain was basically shoveling gold from all of its exploits on the other side of the ocean, England, ever the great team player that it is, said, you know what? It would be a shame if some of those ships would go to waste. If those Spanish ships would never reach the coast of Spain, and all their monetary value would be lost. And you know what? It would even be better if that monetary value would come to our pockets. So they, in the late 16th century, they started hiring the English sea dogs, like Francis Drake, who started engaging with the Spanish fleet, who was going from the New World to the Old World, plundering them, trying to take them down, and getting all the money for the English crown instead of, you know, the Spanish crown.
Yar, sea dogs. Yeah. So, after a while, as things started to heat up, this was still very low key. This was state-sanctioned piracy, but it was very low key. So not a lot of things were still happening. This wasn't really the Golden Age just yet, not like we know it. But once the European unions, the European nations started to get a decent foothold in the New World, they started actually building settlements all over the Caribbean. And the Caribbean is a huge area of sea with a lot of islands, a lot of different islands, and everyone was just spread out all over those things. And new islands were being found every week, new routes, new maritime naval activity was being discovered all the time. And you could just up and vanish in those regions. And of course, a lot of those sea dogs, people who were under the command of the English crown and even the French crown, they were suddenly like, hey, why should we, risk our own lives to get all these Spanish ships out of the sea to just go all the way back to Europe and give it to the French or English crown? Why not take it for ourselves? And it's that realization in 1650, 1680, where all the buccaneers, the French and English pirates, where they realized, hey, we can make a big buck here. And yeah, they actually started doing that, just that. They realized, okay, maybe we should start doing this for ourselves. And of course, the English crown, the French crown, and of course the Spanish, because they knew this was happening, they all realized that piracy was a thing. Because they were losing ships left and right, and the English, or the French, they realized that, well, not everything that we, not all the reports of ships being sunk or being captured by our buccaneers are being returned to us. We don't see a lot of profits while, judging by what our spies say the Spanish are losing, we should be rolling in money right now. So we have a couple of competitors for everything that, is sailing the seas. So the European nations were like reluctantly acknowledging the fact that, oh shit, we might have created something that we can't quite handle, but it isn't a problem just yet. Sowing, oh no, reaping. Yeah, indeed. Oh no, the consequences to my actions. That is the story of European history, to be honest. And then, mostly, if I can be so crude, the British. But we all have like a hand in that, so I'm not gonna just target them. They know what they did. I hope. At some point. So, in 1697, or 1696, Captain Henry Avery's capture of a Mughal ship, the Ganges-e-Sawai, brings significant attention to piracy because suddenly it's not just, oh, I just invisible VS, WS. Welcome in. Thank you for the follow. Hope you like what you're gonna see and what you're gonna hear. So the Mughal ship is a very prominent ship. It has a lot of silver aboard, it has some dignitaries aboard, and suddenly it hits the people where
the nobles, the kings, where they live. And then they realize, okay, this piracy thing isn't gonna go away. As long as we put money on the seas, these people are gonna try and take that money. So we might have to address that. But again, white people being white people, let's say it like that, they had a bigger fish to fry at that moment, because Europe was embroiled in a war, namely the Spanish Succession War, or the War of the Spanish Succession. And the War of the Spanish Succession taxed a lot of resources. It was a huge maritime war, where a lot of people in Europe were involved in. And yeah, that took a hefty toll, which made sure that there wasn't a lot of guards present in the New World. So yeah, pirates could just go ahead. Even more so, the War of the Spanish Succession, after the war, there were loads of sailors who were just being laid off because, yeah, the war is over, they don't need sailors anymore. And they were just let go. And those people who were ditched, who were out of a job, but had experience manning ships and fighting wars on the seas, were like, okay, we're being ditched by our people, so why shouldn't we just go to the New World and just keep doing what we're good at? You know, we fought this war for over 10 years. We have no family, we have no home. Our home is, you know, the hull of a ship. Why shouldn't we just go and make our fortune in the New World? And ever since the end of the War of Spanish Succession, there is a flood of new pirates. It is just a huge influx of new sailors, new pirates in the New World. And from 1716, for the next 10 years, there is a rush in the Golden Age of Piracy. Not only that, the Spanish crown thought to get as much out of the New World as they could the moment, because they knew shit was gonna go down. And some of the largest Spanish silver fleets was making a tour away from the New World in 1715 and got caught in a storm. And a load of silver, like the biggest amount of silver in one place up until that point in history, sank. And that just triggered a silver rush in everyone. Suddenly, those who weren't even convinced that the New World was the answer, they were going there, and they all wanted a piece of that silver. They were looking all over the place for the location of the silver fleet. They knew that the Spaniards were gonna try and recover that. They knew that the English were gonna try and recover that first. And yeah, everyone wanted to get in on the game before it was being played. So yeah, at that point, basically all the great pirates that we know from history are aboard. Quite literally. And you see the rise in the next 10 years from 1716 to 1727, from pirates like Calico Jack, Bartholomew Roberts, Blackbeard, Anne Bonny, Black Sam Bellamy. All pirates like that, they just come out of the woodwork and yeah, they are swarming the Caribbean. And it's for 10 years that Europe basically gets nothing out of the New World, because almost every ship that they send is being taken down, is being intercepted by pirates, and there is just no influx of goods coming out of the New World anymore. But again, because Europe being Europe, they ravaged themselves to a point where they were too weak to actually do something about it. So they were like, shit, okay, what do we do now? We can't go there. We have to defend our borders here because, yeah, we created this own hell here with all these nations and leaders that don't like each other. So, yeah, it just kept going. The pirates could do whatever they want because it was only local governors who had some say and some capabilities of stopping them. And even then, they were not too well equipped to deal with all of that. So yeah, pirates ran rampant, basically. Not helped by the fact that a lot of those settlements that they created in the Caribbean, some of them were actually siding with the pirates. And because, you know, hey, if there's a lot of money going around, why don't you help the people with a lot of money? And some of those settlements became famous pirate havens. And that lasted, like I said, for only a short time. Like 10 years, tops. And then things started to go south. Because the nations in Europe started to recover. After a while, a lot of good people were dying. And luck would run out for most of these pirates. And not only luck, but their tactics will start to wear off. And I'll get into their tactics a bit later. But the use and the efficacy of their tactics would wane with time, of course. And yeah, after a while, there was nothing left and they started meeting their ends. You had Bartholomew Roberts who died, Edward Teach, Blackbeard, who got killed. And in a very short amount of time, all those great pirate names, those feared robbers of the sea, were taken down one by one by the establishment. And eventually in 1726, the pirate named William Fly was hanged publicly, and that is considered to be the final pirate of the great pirate, the Golden Age of Piracy, to be done in, to be captured, to be taken out. So, live fast, die young. You get what, you see what I'm getting at. These pirates, this glorious age that we envisioned for ourselves, is only a very small piece of history, but it's a time where so much happened and where a lucky couple of few people used the political upheaval in Europe to get the most out of it for themselves. Now, after the Golden Age of Piracy, piracy didn't go away. As you know, there's still pirates around. But it shifted away from the area from the of the Caribbean. It went to the Chinese Sea. The South China. Hey, control map delete. Welcome in. I was just telling about the end of the Golden Age of Piracy. So, piracy shifted because, yeah, the stage on which the
theater of war was being played was shifting as well. And instead of the West Indies, it became the East Indies. So everything in India, Pakistan, China, Japan, suddenly that was the stage for pirates. And there were a lot of pirates there. There are numerous stories about Chinese, Japanese pirates who have made name for themselves as well in history. But of course, us being, you know, Western-minded, we don't get a lot of those stories, while there are actually really cool stories about those pirates as well. Now, I'm gonna not make them too light because, you know, they're brown from working out in the sun all the time. So yeah, after a while, pirates were basically hunted into oblivion. Like, some got the chance to be privateers, where they could be state-sanctioned again and fight against the establishment that, of course, their chosen faction, their chosen lord, would point out. Like, if you're a French privateer, you would probably go against the British for a very long time. If you're a Spanish privateer, you would go against the British most of the time. Let's just say you would be fighting British ships a lot at a certain point. Yeah, but eventually in 1856, European nations in the Declaration of Paris would officially and finally abolish all forms of piracy by, let's say, cultured civilizations. So everyone who, like, cares about Paris in some way, like, if you are a political opponent or not, or if you are a proponent, everyone who thinks that Paris has some sort of might, signed in on that accord, and they abolished piracy completely. Now, if you follow the news a bit, if you know what's up in the world, you know that, for example, in some African countries there is still piracy going on, like famous are Somalian pirates. So piracy is not completely eradicated. This is a really weird sea shanty. I don't know if you can hear it, but fun. Now, in chat, before we go any further, I'd like to explain a couple things, but I want your input. We all know the term pirates. But do you know any other term for a pirate? Like I've just said, there is privateer, there's buccaneer, but are there any more that you know of? If you have some, just let me know. Brits! Is that an actual term for pirates? I'd say that's a term for, well, they steal and plunder, sure. Over here in Argentina it is. Oh, Well, I'm sure you have a very good reason.
Trouble with the sound again. Like, Films for West, do you have trouble with the sound, or can't, or is there trouble with my sound? Because I can help with one, but not with the other.
Rovers.
Yeah, rovers is another term. Brits.
I'm pretty sure that Argentina has a reason to call pirates Brits. Because I'm pretty sure that a lot of the pirates over there were British. And the British acted like pirates in most of the occasions, so
yeah. Now, there are a lot of different terms. Like I said, pirate, privateer, buccaneer, corsair, marauder, sea rover, freebooter, filibuster, raider, picaroon, swashbuckler. Those are all different names for pirates, and they are being used interchangeably for the word pirate. However, each one of those has an actual distinct, explanation. They have a distinct meaning. Like, for example, a pirate is just an individual who engages in maritime robbery and other criminal activities without the sanction of any nation. Pirates attack, plunder, and seize ships, cargo, valuables, people, and their actions are considered illegal by all nations. So they completely operate outside the law and are subject to prosecution by any nation that captures them. So, that is just saying, pirates are pretty much complete criminals. While privateers, you might have already guessed from what I said, privateers are legalized pirates. They operate within the acceptance of one government. Can't wait until you reach the Corsair part. Well, it's coming. So, privateers have a letter of marque, which means that one crown, one nation, actually told them, hey, you guys can be pirates, as long as you just be a pirate for us. Meaning, don't attack our ships, and you can pirate all the shit you want. This is basically what happened when the French and English were saying, hey, if you want to rob ships out in the Caribbean, sure, but only do it with the Spanish ships. Those are privateers. So like I said, Sir Francis Drake, people say that he's a pirate. No, Francis Drake was a privateer for the British Crown. He isn't a pirate. Invisible. A corsair were privateers, so they were holders of a letter of marque. They were in, they were commissioned by a country, but they only operated in the Mediterranean Sea. So a corsair was someone who just sailed the seas and was a privateer on the Mediterranean. And they mostly sailed from the North African ports like Algiers and Tunis. They were also commissioned by most of the Barbary states, and they tried to take a piece of the European shipping. So, yeah, a corsair, mostly a North African pirate, who preyed on the Europeans, because, hey, why not? Now, the thing is, at that time, a lot of Algiers, North Africa. I have you on two browsers. I'm logged in Microsoft Edge where I can chat, but there is no sound, so I also have you on my Google Chrome with sound, but forgot my password, so can't log in. That seems like a very troublesome situation you're in, Films. Hope it works out. Hope you can still enjoy the show. Now, because, like I said, because north of France is heavily influenced by the French and the French colonization, a lot of the corsairs eventually made it into the Caribbean as well. And corsair was sometimes used for a French-speaking pirate or privateer in the Caribbean as well. But most of the time, those were North African pirates, privateers, I'm sorry, in the Mediterranean Sea. They had their own lore, they had their own ways of life, of doing things. But yeah, sometimes it's being used interchangeably with pirates. I like this soundtrack because it's the soundtrack of Sea of Thieves. I love that game. Now, then you have the term buccaneer. The Corsair is one of my favorite airplanes. Yes. I doubt it has anything to do with an airplane, though. Now, a buccaneer were those original hunters and settlers from the French and English in the Caribbean. So when they were settling Hispaniola in the 17th century, they hunted wild cattle, pigs, and all manner of things from the islands that they were settling. What kind of pirate was Jack Sparrow in the movies then? Probably the best pirate you'd ever heard of. Or the worst pirate you ever heard of. Jack Sparrow. Jack Sparrow was a privateer, apparently, because he was at a certain point, if you get the backstory, he was under the East Indian Company. He had a letter of marque, and he was transporting goods and taking goods and cargo from one place to the other for the East Indian Trading Company. But at a point, he was asked to transport slaves. That's why at a point in the movie, he says to Lord Beckett, people aren't cargo, mate. Yeah. And he broke his contract because he freed his slaves, and he was marked a pirate because he stole from, you know, the one who gave him his letter of marque, which goes against the contract, goes against the letter of marque, and that makes you a pirate. So Jack Sparrow is in fact a pirate. From that point on, of course. No, but a buccaneer is someone who does crimes on the high seas, but instead of fighting ship to ship, they are fighting ship to land, ship to settlement, ship to tribe. They make landfall and they attack on land. They raid villages, they steal cattle, they raid settlements. Yeah, like Vikings. Yes, so buccaneers were, you know, not adventures on the high seas. No, we stay along the coastline and we scavenge everything we can. And if push comes to shove, we stab a couple people and take their cows. And the reason why they're called buccaneers is because they had this way of quickly hunting down cattle and pigs, slaughtering them, and then smoking the meat on a wooden frame called a boucan. So a buccaneer was just smash, grab, go away. And that's why they were called buccaneers, because of, well, they took everything they could, they slaughtered everything on the spot, smoked the meat, took it where they needed it, I guess. Yeah, and since most of the tribes that they were attacking, the one with cattle, pigs, and other wildlife, they were natives, what they did wasn't considered illegal. Because at the time, people in the New World, the tribes that were there, weren't considered people. So they could just do with those people what they wanted. They could raid them. So buccaneers, again, they were the first settlers from France and England. They did what they had to do from the English and French crown, and they weren't attacking people, quote unquote.
Fucked up as it might be.
Now, rovers, sea robbers, those are normal words. Those mean the same thing as a pirate. They can be changed. They can be used interchangeably without, you know, breaking definition. Freebooter is the same, because freebooter is actually a Dutch word. That was used. A freebooter means a vrijbuiter, which means a plunderer. So, plunderer, Dutch word is vrijbuiter, that got bastardized to freebooter, which is also just, you know, the same as a pirate. Same with filibusters. Filibusters are the same who go against the Spanish raiders. Yeah, those who are performing raids. A picaroon is also a French term that got used and then changed. It's it's a Spanish term. It's derived from the Spanish word picaron, or picaron, which means scoundrel or rascal. I assume in this situation that means scoundrel. And they refer to picaroons as, you know, pirates. So, and then we have the swashbuckler. A swashbuckler was never used at the time. Swashbucklers is something that, you know, was created later. Mostly by Hollywood. Because, of course, I'm just looking at this miniature and what kind of colors I want to give her. A swashbuckler, yeah, that's a swaggering, blustering swordsman. And that doesn't sound too great, but that's because it wasn't supposed to sound great. It was someone who was basically full of shit. Who was just sweeping his sword, his saber everywhere without doing anything, really. But right now, a swashbuckler is actually mostly the hero of the story, if we think about pirates. We think of swashbuckling pirates, the swashbuckling hero, the dude who climbs up the mast and then cuts a rope and swings across to land on top of, I don't know, the poop deck and challenges the captain to a match of swords. I was losing my words there. Yeah, but that's it. That image started to exist the moment that people started thinking of the adventurous types that were to be associated with pirates. And then it started to becoming something positive. So instead of someone who was full of bullshit, it became the mark of a hero. If you're a swashbuckler, oh yeah, you're pretty cool, you're hot stuff. But yeah, it's basically a fake title. It has nothing to do with actual piracy. So, if you're going about and you see the term swashbuckling being used, know that it's probably being used in the wrong way. Now you can be one of those people who says,
actually.
So yeah. Saying this, you probably realize, like, there is a lot of depth to
just sitting on a boat and stealing things.
Like, if it were only that, easy, right? But no, it's way more complex. There is a lot of politics involved, there's a lot of history, and one pirate isn't the next. Now, gonna see
what my next talking point. You're technically correct, the best kind of correct. About what? If I'm wrong, please correct me about the swashbuckling. Okay, very well. Please, Control Math Delete. Continue. Tell me. Now, while Control Math Delete is, was just referencing, you can use this. Oh, yeah, okay. Indeed. I thought you were gonna correct me on something. Which, you know, if you guys know more than me, please let me know. I'm always willing to learn more about the subject that I'm talking about. Now, in the Discord, I got a question. From Dark Chasey, I believe it was, who asked, like, hey, are there actually legendary pirates? The answer? Yes, definitely. There are some historically very important people who happen to be pirates. So, legendary pirates do exist, and we all know at least one of them. Blackbeard, Edward Teach, or Teak. Depends on how you want to pronounce it, did actually exist. He was a feared pirate. Yes, there's only one per booster pack. Yes.
I'm just thinking about how I can paint these. Like, This lovely young lady, what kind of hair color do you want to give her? I'm thinking red. What do you think? Let me know. Yeah, but Blackbeard, Edward Teach. I like to think Blackbeard was a ginger. Yes, no, he wasn't. He had black hair, so, yeah. No, but Blackbeard was a very famous pirate. The reason why he was famous because he played the game very well, and I'm gonna come back to it a bit later. He commanded the ship Queen Anne's Revenge, and he utilized terror tactics to a T. He was mostly known for, you know, braiding long or slow burning fuses into his beard and his hair, and then igniting them the moment that they came near a ship they wanted to attack. And because fuses tend to make a lot of sparks, embers, and smoke, it gave him a very fearsome countenance, and people were just too fucking scared about of him. So yeah, Blackbeard is a very famous and legendary pirate because he was a very successful pirate until he was, of course, killed. Yeah, he used pyrotechnics. You have two famous female pirates, Anne Bonny and Mary Read, who were on the crew of Calico Jack Rackham. They disguised themselves as men, and they were two of his most loyal and effective lieutenants. And it is said that only after being arrested that the authorities finally realized that they were women and not men. We don't know how much... they were roommates. We don't know much... we don't know if Calico Jack Rackham knew if they were women. But, yeah, I think... that's like a fun story. Like, yeah, these awful people here that have been raiding our outposts, we finally got them in. They're women, sir. Excuse me, what? So yeah, that is something that we also have to take into account. A lot of women took part in the Golden Age of Piracy because, yeah, sometimes there is just no other way for a woman to go and they have to just stab a few people and raid some ships. I'm gonna go for a redhead, so. Then we have Bartholomew Roberts, one of the most famous pirates, except for, of course, maybe Blackbeard, who was named Black Bart. Girl Bart. Girl Boss Gaslight Gatekeep Pillage, yes. Bartholomew Roberts, he was said to have captured over 400 ships in his lifetime. It is more than most pirates ever combined, and that is saying something, because there were some very impressive pirates out there, but apparently Black Bart, Bartholomew Roberts, was very good at capturing ships. And you know, adding them to his fleet of pirate ships as well. Apparently had a motto, and the motto was a merry life and a short one, which is basically live fast, die young. So we got Black Bart to thank for that quote, I guess. And you might think, like, okay, well, how did he meet his end? Well, apparently he was on his way to Africa, and off the coast of Africa he got killed in a naval battle that he wasn't even, you know, part of. So, sucks to be him, I guess. Then we have Captain Kidd, William Kidd, Bill Kidd, William Kidd, Captain Kidd, again, who was actually a privateer and who was accused of becoming a pirate. The problem is that apparently there was never any evidence that he actually was a pirate. The only confirmed ships that he took were those that he should have taken based on his letter of marque. So he was hunted down as a pirate while he was just being a private, a privateer. Now, why is William Kidd famous? Is because William Kidd allegedly had a huge treasure hidden somewhere. He had a huge treasure that he would have hidden on Long Island in America. And that sparked loads of treasure hunt legends about it. And that's probably the thing where we have to thank the whole treasure hunting thing for. Captain Kidd's treasure, it's never found. There's a lot of people who have still have theories about it today, where it's supposed to be, what it is, where it's going, what it's like the temple treasure. Like, nobody knows where it's actually at, but a lot of people like to think that they know. And yeah, William Kidd became a legendary pirate because of his alleged treasure. And again, he wasn't even a pirate, he was a privateer. So yeah. Have that as your
lifelong your legacy, I mean.
Then we have Calico Jack, or John Rackham, who is famous for coining the term Jolly Roger. Jolly Roger being the very recognizable flag with the skull and crossbones. Now, there is more. To that than just, oh, it's a nice piece of decoration.
Let me get into that in just a bit. I'm first gonna finish this dude's hair. She rises.
I'm not gonna sing, I'm sorry.
I think this man has a goatee, but I'm not quite sure. I'm just gonna give him a goatee. Looks like a goatee wearer.
See if there's any more. Yeah, there's more, but I think we've got it right now. So, I think, again, it was Dark Chasey who asked about the Jolly Roger, the flag with the, you know, the skull and crossbones. What's up with that? Well, the thing is, that's a load of crock, basically. So, yeah, if you, I'm just quickly going through my notes here. Yeah. So, you have the black and white Jolly Roger flag with skull and crossbones. Now, the Jolly Roger was associated with pirates. Like, again, Calico Jack Rackham used it probably as a first one, but pirates used a variety of flags. You see, having a flag is one of the easiest ways to communicate from ship to ship. So, if you are sailing the high seas and you come across a ship, I'm gonna give her a blue outfit. If you come across a ship, you can try and signal them, but most of the time you're not getting their attention so quickly. So what do? You send out a signal. What is the easiest thing to do is, well, you hope that they see you and you raise a colored flag. Now, which flag did they raise? They raised a black flag. Most of the time, a pirate mostly raises a black flag, but that was a normal black flag. That flag was just a full black square.
What does the square mean? What does it mean? The numbers, Mason. Sorry, that's an obscure reference.
What does the black flag mean? It means quarter given. For some people, that's not an answer, and you don't know what that actually means. So I'm gonna explain. Quarter given means that the pirates are signaling, hey, we want everything you have, and if you surrender, we will show you mercy. So, we will give you quarter. The moment they'll give a reasonable amount of time for the other ship to see that flag and to raise their flag in response. So, the black flag is just saying, hey, we want your stuff, do as we say, and no one will get hurt. If the people then don't immediately react, or they don't want to surrender, or they take too long, or whatever, then they would switch over to a red flag. And the red flag means no quarter given. Basically saying, hey, we're gonna come and get your stuff, and we're gonna kill you either way. So, it was a scare tactic. Now, think about this in a kind of logical, pragmatic way. You are a pirate. You are on the seas. You are basically on a large, beautifully crafted piece of wood with your loyal friends, your compatriots, your men-at-arms, and you are looking to make a buck. Do you want to spend every day in fear of being hunted down, being sunk, being wounded, being dead? No. You want to get rich, but you don't necessarily want to die for it. Of course, that is always something that is implied. You are fighting for your freedom, you are free people, all those great ideals, but it would be better if they would just give you everything without you having to lift a finger. And that's where eventually the terror tactics came into play, and where the Jolly Roger came in. Because you see, if a Spanish fleet or a Spanish ship would see a black flag, they would know, shit, these are pirates. Oh, merde, mierde. I don't know what Spanish say. Mierda. Putain. Oh, that's the French. Look, we don't want to die. This is only the Spanish crown's gold or stuff. If we would just give it to the pirates, we stay alive. And that's absolutely right. Mierda. thanks for confirming. If we would just hand them the gold or the silver or all the goods, then we don't die and they would leave us alone. So that's what they would do, and the pirates would accept that. Even so far as creating acts to make it more likely that their quarry, their prey, is intimidated to the point that they surrender. So instead of just a normal black flag saying that, hey, it's okay if you just give us your gold, they would try and hype it up a bit. And they would start designing their own flags. They would add skulls as to show, like, hey, surrender or die. They would add, like, hourglasses to indicate or to threat that the ship's time was running out. They would add maybe sabers, a heart. Just to show that, yeah, it's gonna get bloody, it's gonna get, we're gonna fuck you up. So yeah, it was all basically a tactic, and that is the reason why, for example, Blackbeard lit those fuses in his beard, because the dude knew exactly what was going on. He's like, hey, If these people are shitting their pants, they're absolutely not gonna fight me. If they think I'm a ghost, some sort of paranormal entity, a larger-than-life figure, then they're not gonna fucking mess with me. And I can just walk up to them, take their ship, take their gold, sail the fuck out of there, and have no wounded, lose no crew, no damage to my ship. Easy as pie. And that's the whole thing. It was a scare tactic. After a while, these legendary pirates, they played the game. They wanted to be famous. They wanted to be feared. Not because they were violent, some of them absolutely were, but because people thought they were violent. Because people thought that they would kill them just by looking at them. That having a pirate near you is, you know, reason enough to just say, well, fuck it, time to surrender. Because you didn't want to, you know, just in case. And a lot of people were just terrorized by pirates into complying and surrendering their ships. So all those cool naval battles that you see where they board each other, those happened. But not as often as you think in piracy. Most of the time it was a merchant ship who saw a pirate, was like, yep, it's one of those days. Just drop anchor, raise the white flag, let them come aboard, let them take everything, we'll say hi. Oh, it's Calico Jack. Hey, Calico, how are you doing? And they would just get off again. Because, yeah, that's what you have to do, because you don't want to risk losing your lives. Now, where does the name Jolly Roger come from then? First of all, there are two theories. First is that it's a name that Black Bart invented. That's what he named his flag. He said, well, I'm going to be the first to customize my flag, because that's also a thing. We have the Jolly Roger, the skull and crossbones, but if you customize it and they see your flag, then your reputation starts preceding you. If you see, I think it's a skeleton with an arrow and a heart is for Blackbeard. If you saw that, you knew that Blackbeard was coming, and people's imagination was already starting to race. Oh no, it's Blackbeard, the dude who's on fire. Yeah, so having unique flags was way more important than flying the regular Jolly Roger. Because the Jolly Roger just meant, yeah, okay, that's a pirate, but it's probably a no-name pirate. So we might actually have a chance, while having a very distinctive coat of arms, having your very unique flag flying over you, that is something to be afraid of. And the Jolly Roger would have been Calico Jack Rackham's first flag. That is one theory. That's how we called his flag. The other theory is that the French, which they named the second flag that would be raised. So like I said, you've always had like the first black flag who says, hey, we're gonna raid you, surrender, and you will be shown mercy. And after that, a red flag would be raised. Now, what the theory is the red flag was colloquially named Le Joli Rouge, the pretty red flag. So basically it's the French saying like, okay, we better surrender before they raise that pretty red flag. Nous ferions mieux de nous rendre avant qu'il ne soulève le Joli Rouge. And Joli Rouge, Jolly Roger, that was the name for a pirate flag, because the pirate flag meant the same as those two flags combined. Like, if you surrender, we'll leave you alone. If you don't, we'll kill all of you. So, think about that. We have the movies where everyone speaks English, but like I said earlier, there were Spanish, there were French, there were Englishmen, there were Portuguese, there were Italians, there were North Africans, there were people from Africa, from America, that were all joining up. They were speaking all manner of languages. And having having heard reference to Le Joli Rouge might have changed over time to C'est le Joli Roger. I don't know. So there's multiple explanations for why the Jolly Roger is actually named the Jolly Roger. It could be a combination of both. It could be the reference to Joli Rouge, and Black Bart just said, well, this is going to be my Jolly Rouge, and I'm going to call it Jolly Roger. Who knows? So that is a myth busted for some people? I don't know. Let me know what you think about the whole Jolly Roger thing. Really excited to know what you guys think about it. Oh yeah, and you guys know that the first couple of or the first stream is always like the base layers, and those are least interesting to watch because yeah, those are basically just coloring in a miniature. It's not really looking that great, but at a certain point we'll get there. Also, this playlist is a hit and a miss. Now there is like a band of kazoos playing. This is weird. What do you mean? It's perfect! Figures that you would say so. It did sound funny though, so
now.
I'm gonna continue in a bit, just catching my words, gonna drink a bit.
Now that we're busy talking about the truth of the situation, I'm gonna talk a bit more about famous pirate myths that are just not true. Simply not true. And that we do see pop up a lot in popular media. First one, walking the plank. Apparently, in popular media, pirates frequently force captives to walk off a plank extending from the ship's edge into the sea. As a punishment, as something very cruel that they do, which has no apparent use. But yeah, it's just not true. That there's no indication that any pirate has ever done that. Walking a plank, it could be a gangplank, which is just to get off and on the ship. But nowhere is walking the plank seen as a form of cruelty or punishment in real life. It's mostly to show that, okay, these pirates in fiction are very cruel and they will absolutely kill someone. Also, the idea that sharks would know that a random ship that just passes through their waters would have like a plank and they would circle underneath that plank waiting to be fed. Yeah, that's just fiction. Just don't believe any of that. pirate speak.
Aye, me mates. You be talking like a pirate.
The distinct accent that pirates have, completely fake. It is also from the 1950s Treasure Island movie where Long John Silver talks like that. It is one actor who made that role so iconic that it has tainted the idea of pirates forever. Like I said earlier, pirates came from all manner of regions and they spoke a lot of languages. Yeah, they would have heavy accents, but that's because they all had different native languages and still tried to communicate with one another. But the arr, me matey. Yes, Kalewags. No, that's just the fictionalized accent. So sorry for people who really like the 12th of September, which is Talk Like a Pirate Day. Because that means you just have to talk normally, because pirates were just talking normal. Buried treasure. Again, this is something that came into being. This myth came into being after the idea of Captain Kidd and his treasure was being spread among the masses. Like I said earlier, there is no reason to believe that Captain Kidd ever did this. And there's no reason that pirates ever done that. If they got loot, they most certainly immediately spent it on supplies, repairs, and, you know, having a rich and fun life. So, also don't forget that there was a law present in the Caribbean, and most of the time that law was bribed. Like I said, you had pirate havens, and those local governors were just all too happy to let pirates into their harbors if they paid a fee. So a lot of the pirates' gold and treasure immediately went to paying off debts, to bribes, to, again, repairs, provisions, and entertainment. And that's the reason why they kept going out, not because they were like Robin Hood and they had some ideal of plundering everyone. No, it's because they needed to do that, otherwise they would run dry rather quickly. So yeah, buried treasure? No, a pirate rather spent his money than ever put it in the ground. Apparently that's something that's really hard to understand for people who still believe that, like, treasure still exists somewhere. I get the romanticized idea, of course, but yeah, unfortunately, all treasure is probably being spent, melted, or whatever. Now, flamboyant dressing. You might think about pirate captains having extravagant clothing, large hats with a feather, boots, buckles, all these manner of frills, some looking like French noblemen who stepped aboard a ship and just look dilapidated. They just want to look extravagant. No, it's really shitty to be on a ship for a couple of weeks. You would dress in something that is quite easy to wear, especially in an area like the Caribbean, where it's really hot, so wearing 3 or 4 layers of cloth is something that you'd rather not want to do. Also, pirate captains were not just sitting in their cabin the entire time, they were actively helping on the ship. So they needed to go around and be able to climb a mast if need be. Because, you know, you're not just gonna wait around till someone else is doing it while you were perfectly capable of doing it. So, yeah, flamboyant dressing, not so much. It could be that they kept mementos, like maybe a ring from a haul,
maybe a memento from a family member back in the old world or something like that. But those would have been few and far in between. And like I said, not a lot in the way of showing off that they are rich. Again, they had plenty of other things to spend their money on that wasn't just clothing that would get ripped and dirty the second they got on board again. So, unfortunately, another one busted. Now, that doesn't mean that pirates are, not cool anymore. There are actually a lot of cool anecdotes about pirates. Like I said, Edward Teach, Blackbeard, had this fearsome appearance because he would light slow-burning fuses into his beard and under his hat. So there were smoke and embers around his face, and people actually started saying that he was some sort of demonic pirate. And that they, you know, if you encountered him, you better forfeit everything you had, because otherwise he would just simply take everything and leave you to die. Just quickly gonna do some speed paint here to get it on quickly. Now, another one, again, famous pirate Black Bart. And I feel that we don't know Black Bart nearly as well as we should, because he is actually a very interesting person. Like I said, he was a very notorious pirate, had a huge amount of ships that he captured during his lifetime, during his active years as a pirate. For people who have played Assassin's Creed Black Flag, Black Bart is also the main... No, I think that's Pirate Roberts. I don't know. Isn't Black Bart? It could be that Bartholomew Roberts is actually the villain of Assassin's Creed Black Flag. I'm drawing a blank now. Forgive me for that. But Bartholomew Roberts also had another thing going for him. He was very fond of tea. He loved the stuff. He was a tea enthusiast, true and true, that at a certain point he lamented the fact that there were no tea ships in the West Indies. And that he wanted tea so badly that he sailed his ship all the way to the East Indies to actually capture a ship that was loaded with tea from India. So, the dude wanted tea, so he stole a ship from the other side of the world just to sail it back to the Caribbean to have a huge tea party with his crew in the Caribbean. I'm sorry, but that's pretty cool. It's not because pirates are outside the law that they don't have the backing of any country anymore, that they lack any national pride. It is such that Jean Lafitte, he was a pirate and privateer. This is long after the Golden Age of Piracy. This is in 1812, so that's a long time later. He was a privateer who still operated around New Orleans, and during the War of 1812, he played a key role in the Battle of New Orleans by aiding General Andrew Jackson.
He aided the Americans, despite being sought by the US government for piracy. Despite being a wanted man, he still came to the aid of General Andrew Jackson and provided critical support with his men and knowledge of the local terrain so that Andrew Jackson actually won the Battle of New Orleans. And for that, Andrew Jackson, the future president of the United States at that point, just let him go and was like, okay, man, you've shown that you are still an American at some point. Yeah, and he let him go, which, you know, that's something that you can still do, like, aid the US government and then be pardoned for your crimes, right? Now, now we'll get to some myths. Myths that pirates believed in. I'm gonna start with one that Control Math Delete asked me. Because he had a Magic the Gathering related question. See, the thing is, pirates believe in sea monsters. There's a lot of sea monsters around, and one of them that the pirates fear are sirens. Sirens are beautiful, feminine creatures. No, I'm not addicted. Not saying you are. Sirens are feminine creatures that use their allure to draw men in and drag them to their doom. Now, the question that Control Math Delete had on the Discord is, by the way, if you want to join the Discord, you can. I just posted the link. The question he asked is like, hey, in Greek mythology, sirens are always depicted with wings. They have wings, they fly, they are like harpies. While later, when we go to the Caribbean pirates, and the Caribbean seafarers, you have more of like the sirens are mermaids. How come there is like a distinction between mermaids and harpies, and they're both counted as sirens? Because, you know, what happened to the wings? Why are they suddenly tailed for fish people? What's up with that? Well, the thing is, the myth of sirens has its roots in Greek mythology. Greek mythology or Greece? Greek. The thing is, harpies are indeed birds with the face and part of the upper torso of a woman. Same goes for sirens there. The thing is, harpies are full of rage and vengeance, while sirens are alluring creatures that will draw you in with their song. Indeed, they have wings. And that has to do with the fact that all monsters in Greek mythology are based in the divine. They are all messengers of the gods. They are all coming from the gods. They are from up there, pointing upwards. That is why they have wings. Also, Greek sailors, they have like a very dense area in the Mediterranean where they perform their trade. It's full of islands, it's full of rocks. They sail from coast to coast. And what do you see on those rocks? You see birds. You see loads and loads of birds. All across the Mediterranean, within the Greek island groups, you have birds who can fly from one island to the next, because the distance is not that far. So, if you have a mythological monster in mind, it would have wings, because it's actively doing the thing that those birds are doing. You see some large birds on top of rocks circling, well, watch out, it could be a siren. Now, when the Golden Age of Piracy came around, and we started going way farther out to sea, well, you didn't have islands to hop on and hop to the entire time. And after a while, you wouldn't find any more birds. So, having a bird-like monster would be weird. Also, at that point, Christianity was way more involved, and having wings and, let's say, humanoid features was considered angelic, and monsters can be angelic, so they ditched the wings. Because first of all, those monsters have nowhere to perch, so they must be fish, right? And because they're sexy, they can't be divine, and because they're not angelic, you know, they had to ditch the wings either way. So that's the reason why after a while people were like, yeah, no, those sirens who can lure you to your watery death, they don't drag you away to smash you on top of the rocks in the Aegean Sea. No, they drag you under the water. It was basically just let's change the story to fit the environment we're in. So, I don't know what I can tell you, but the reason why sirens lost their wings was because if they had wings, they had to be able to sit on rocks. And because they couldn't, well, they had to ditch the wings and just become fish people instead. Hey, you can't keep a good story down. And I think it's amazing how people are like, yeah, sirens, yeah, they still exist. What, those bird women? No, 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 they're fish women now. Okay. I mean, apparently if you're long enough on at sea, you start seeing women everywhere, I guess. Even that fish starts to look good. So yeah. Which is the correct version, Contromath Delete? Well, they're both correct. It just depends on which source material you want to use. If you want to use medieval or Renaissance depiction, a siren is a mermaid. If you want to go back to the original recreation of a siren, then you have to actually go to the more harpy-like depiction of her. But both are sirens, both are considered correct, and to be fair, I like the way The Witcher games did it. Sea cows look like sirens. That's where it came from. No, no, that is not true. Sea cows don't look like sirens. But that is a very widely accepted truth that, hey, maybe they just saw like manatees or something and they thought it was other stuff. So the card I sent was wrong, because that pirate, that was a pirate setting. Yes, actually it was. It had a feeling of a Caribbean pirate setting, and in a Caribbean pirate setting, a siren would have been a fish lady. But like I said, the game Witcher 3 brings you to the Skellige Isles at a certain point, and he and Geralt there encounter sirens. And those sirens are mermaids sitting on top of rocks until you get close, trigger their attack, and then they unfold their fins and they fly off. It is a perfect combination of both the myths and the both the representations. They can actually do both. They can fly, they have wings, and they look like mermaids. And I think if you want to look for a good representation of a siren all around, that might be the best one so far, because it combines the both of them in a way that is actually very natural and believable for a mythical creature, of course. So definitely take a look at the sirens from The Witcher 3 game, and you'll definitely see what I mean. But indeed, going by the card that you sent, that should have been a fish person. Or it should have been more of a Greek pirate setting. But yeah. Now, what else do we have? That is another misconception. Or a myth. It's Mesoamerican inspired. Yeah, that's gonna be... Well, the fact is Mesoamericans didn't have... They didn't really have pirates because the Mesoamerican culture weren't seafarers. So, they wouldn't have pirates either way. Yeah, but it's Mesoamerican inspired. But, I love Magic the Gathering's art. They have some really cool art, like you said in Discord as well. They really put in some effort in researching. But it is fantasy anyway, and it is a personal interpretation of, most of the time, what is cool and what they wanted to represent. I mean, take a look at the entire debate on the Lord of the Rings art that Magic the Gathering put out, and you know that, well, their choices aren't always the most popular for what they want to depict. Despite them not being wrong in what they depict. But you know what? I'm not going to start that discussion here. Yeah, it's fantasy. Just make of it what you will. Now, the Flying Dutchman. A lot of people know of, at least have heard of, the Flying Dutchman. Do you guys know of the Flying Dutchman? I'm sure you have. Even if it's just from SpongeBob. I was going to type from SpongeBob. Yes. Well, the Flying Dutchman is one of the most famous ghost ships. It's said to be doomed to sail the oceans forever, never making port. It became popular again, or it gained new notoriety with the Pirates of the Caribbean movies as the ship that was being steered by Davy Jones and his crew. No, part of the ship, part of the crew. Part of the crew, part of the ship, I don't know. Now, sighting the ship was considered to be an omen of doom. But what does it actually mean? Where does it come from? Well, it mostly started in the 17th century. In some stories, in some legends of the Flying Dutchman, the ship's captain was cursed by his cruel behavior or by challenging some divine force and was condemned to sail eternally. A bit like Davy Jones in the movies, because he, he wronged Calypso and she cursed him. In others, the curse arises from a pact with the devil. The captain wanted to get out of a bad situation, made a deal with the devil, and then, yeah, was doomed. The ship is often described as spectral, shrouded in mists, appearing in the distance, bringing darkness with it. But there is actually no evidence that the Flying Dutchman ever existed. It is a folktale. But the legend or the story of the Flying Dutchman has inspired a lot of people, even Richard Wagner, who made the opera The Flying Dutchman, and that kind of cemented the Flying Dutchman and its legend in folklore and history. And people still to this day believe that the Flying Dutchman at some point existed. And it still captures the imagination, symbolizing, you know, eternal damnation on the seas. But yeah, is it true? Is it real? We don't know. Another one, coming back to the sea monsters, is, of course, the Kraken. The Kraken is supposedly this giant sea monster, tentacled, huge creature from the depths of hell that terrorizes sailors and pirates, and it would just come up out of the depths, wrap its tentacles, its claws around the ship, and drag an entire ship and its crew back to the depths. As we know, it's probably a sighting of a very large squid. And people were like, yeah, the squid was at least 3 meters. And the next day, 5 meters. 10 meters. This ship was... The squid was as large as the ship. Yes, stuff like that happens. The thing is that the Kraken isn't something coming from the Caribbean or the Golden Age of Piracy. No, the Kraken is actually a Scandinavian myth, with Scandinavian poets and writers having a lot of a long track record of writing about a Kraken or a Kraken-like creature. They were just cracking a cold one with the boys. Yes. Okay. Now, I'm gonna give you some more myths that pirates believed. And I'm gonna switch away from painting. And just go to chatting. I'm gonna give you some more myths that I want to talk about. I'm just gonna quickly put them open here. And I'm pretty sure that not a lot of you will know this, because I myself wasn't quite aware of them until I did research for the stream. Apparently, and please, tell me if you knew this or not, because I'm really interested in how well known this is. Apparently, it is forbidden to whistle on a ship, because whistling on a ship is believed to challenge the wind itself and summon storms. Apparently, there's a whole superstition that sailors have that if you whistle, you will summon the storm. Now, that of course is superstition. Where does it come from? Well, they believe that it stems from the practice of whistling to notify someone else on the crew. Like, there is a lot of things going on deck. There's all manner of people, there's stuff being brought from one side of the ship to the other, people are crawling down masts, they are dropping anchor, they are raising sails, they're doing all manner of things, and you quickly want to get someone's attention, so puts his fingers in his mouth, whistles really hard. What happens is that everyone stops doing what they're doing, because no one knows who's being whistled at. So, there's a risk of confusion, misplacement, accidents, misdirection, just general mayhem, because suddenly everyone's attention is being drawn from their tasks at hand to whatever the fuck is going on because someone whistled. So, superstition is don't whistle aboard a ship because it summons a storm. More reasonable is don't whistle on a ship because you'll screw everything up. So, yeah, most of the time, if, like, you can, human communicating is at fault once more, yeah. So, yeah, if you would whistle a jolly tune, that's no problem. But if you whistle really hard for attention, they will actually punish you for that.
because you are risking the safety of the entire crew by distracting people from their work. Okay. Another one, which is deeply infused with mysticism, with superstition, is tattoos and piercings. If you think about a pirate, you always have, like, the image of heavily tattooed. They have, like, the teardrop, they have, like, a saber, they have a skull, they have an anchor, they have all manner of shit tattooed on their body, they have piercings. And that was a belief that it would ward off evil spirits, enhance physical attributes, and just bring luck in general. Because most of these pirates couldn't attend church. They were at sea. They could hold a mass, and sometimes they did, but being from such a variety of backgrounds, a crew most of the time couldn't just pin down one religion to follow. So they just made stuff up to feel themselves a bit better about their situation. They would tattoo stuff on them to say, hey, I put this dolphin here, so I, you know, because I want to swim faster. I have this silver earring because silver wards off evil spirits. They did it because they just wanted to have some sort of security for themselves. They wanted to feel safe. They wanted to maybe feel pretty, but most of the time they had some mystical meaning about them as well. Like, they didn't just let themselves be tattooed. They wanted to get something out of it. Because they, well, like I said, they didn't have the other spiritual guidance that normal people who could attend church in those days had. So they kind of had to make it their own. Now, sometimes it's also a very practical thing. Like, sometimes an entire crew would get the same tattoo as part of an identification group. Group identification. To tell a story that is part of your personal life or the troop. Some people have been known to gather earrings for surviving a shipwreck. Just to show off, like, hey, I survived two shipwrecks, if they have two earrings. So, those are... There's all manner of stories according to those tattoos, and most of these tattoos and piercings all have a story to tell and have very significant meaning to the ones getting them. So, yeah. This is one for people who like to play Sea of Thieves. If you played Sea of Thieves, for those who don't know, Sea of Thieves is basically a pirate simulator. You and a group of friends get on a boat, travel the seas, swashbuckle all the way. And during your travels, you have to eat, you have to sleep, you have to just do all manner of things to stay in shape. And probably one of the first things you'll ever do is eat a banana and get the achievement crunch in the process, because you eat a banana with peel and all, which is horrible, and it makes like this crunching noise. Yeah. But bananas were considered to bring bad luck aboard a ship. Bananas were considered to be bad luck. Which is weird as hell. Now, there is a... there are two reasons for it that is believed to lie at the cause of it. First of all, it is true, and you should notice that... You can notice that for yourself. If you buy bananas and you put them in your fruit basket, your fruit tends to spoil faster if bananas are nearby.
The simple fact is bananas do have something that they secrete. I don't know, there's like a working reagent coming from banana peels that makes it so that other food around it spoils more easily. So having a bunch of bananas aboard next to your other provisions tend to, you know, make it spoil. So don't take bananas on a trip where you don't have readily access to fresh fruit. Because those bananas are going to be the only type of fruit you're going to be eating for a long time after all the rest has spoiled. That's one of the most practical reasons. Another one is apparently because they had a lot of African pirates with them. They had a lot of pirates from the Caribbean themselves after a while. They know that in banana bunches, what's it called? A tross? Yeah, banana, whatever. There are certain insects, spiders, venomous spiders, that hide inside banana bunches. If you take like a troop of bananas, put them aboard, you're taking in a lot of, you know, critters that you don't want running around your ship, basically. Yeah, that's it. That's the reason why bananas were not allowed aboard many of the ships. I personally didn't know that. Because again, if you play Sea of Thieves, one of the first things you do when you need healing is bite down on a banana. So yeah. Let's see. Friday departures. Is it also in that time they found out about the gin and tonic? I don't know what you're referring to, the gin and tonic. But I'm pretty sure that gin and tonic aren't that old.
But I could be wrong. Nope. One of the first known instances of gin being mixed with tonic water was in Holland in the 1840s to combat malaria. So it has nothing to do with piracy, unfortunately. That's the thing with most fruit that's already ripe. They indeed secrete a chemical so other nearby fruits ripe faster. The sole purpose is for most of the fruit on a tree to ripen at the same time and thus all be eaten by a nearby animal which spreads the seeds in the fruit. Yeah, true. But apparently bananas do that in a much larger capacity than other fruit. Apparently. That's the reason why they don't take those along. The next one, Friday departures. Setting sail on a Friday was considered highly unlucky. You don't set sail on a Friday. Most likely, this was something that only Christian ships did, or Christian crews on ships, because Friday was the day that Christ was crucified. So yeah. The chemical is ethylene gas, for those who wanted to know. Thank you. So they wouldn't set sail on a Friday. Sometimes, apparently, crews wouldn't even be allowed to say the word Friday. Is it because Christ was crucified on a Friday? Is it because Friday is fish day? I don't know. Could be. I think it's quite fitting because this, to me, also ties into Robinson. Is it Robinson Crusoe? Where he calls his friend / servant Friday, because he met him on a Friday, while if you think about it, Friday is
an unlucky term in maritime settings. So I think that is, you know, because he found Friday on a Friday, that was a lucky thing, and he's kind of countering that. I don't know, I am not great in literary analysis, but to me that immediately made a connection in my mind. So, I don't know. Another thing pirates thought, believed, was that changing a ship's name was considered to bring bad luck. Because some pirates believed that their ship had their own spirits, which could be angered or confused by a name change. If a ship had to be renamed for some reason, then there were strict rituals they had to behold to rename the ship and appease the ship's spirit for that renaming. But just renaming it? No. Did they really believe that their ship was alive? No. But again, that ornate piece of wood in the shape of a ship is the only thing between you and miles upon sea. You better take good care of it. And if there's only a sliver of doubt in your mind that you take good care of your ship and it will take good care of you, then you better roll with it. I mean, might sound stupid, but I name my cars based on the letters in their license plate. I refer to my car as, you know, that entity. I can talk about my car as if it is a person. So why wouldn't a 17th century pirate crew refer to their ship as being another member of the crew, a very valuable member of the crew that you just don't take as just a piece of equipment or a piece of transport? But yeah, this is our ship. This is the ship. We don't want it to get hurt. We don't want it to be destroyed. We want to keep the spirit of the ship alive. This is where you live. This is where you fight, where you're free, where you can do whatever you want. So, yeah. Don't just change the name of your ship. Maybe another one. Yeah. Most of the time we think about pirates as, or pirate crews as being this tyrant of a pirate captain who rules with an iron fist over his crew. That there is a strict hierarchy on the ship. That people can be bullied into compliance. That they all have to be underneath the one above them. That is not true. There were pirate codes. There were articles. There were agreements made per ship, per crew. When a crew came together, they laid out the rules and expectations of the life that they would lead on the ship. Each crew might have like a same-ish code, but in the end, if a crew came to an agreement that some of the code, the regulations should be changed, then they did so. They voted for it. Everyone was expected to abide by those rules. Even the captain. If there were rules set in stone, everyone decided on it, everyone voted on it, then even the captain could not outrank those rules. And those rules were about, how do we divide up the loot? How do we settle disputes? How do we just conduct our normal business on the ship? What if certain needs arise and we have to act? What is the logical follow-through for every situation? And all these rules were democratically chosen and elected. In fact, most of the pirate captains were also democratically chosen. You were there because the crew put you there. Of course, some pirates were so successful that the crew wouldn't even think about replacing you as a captain. Like, for example, Edward Teach. You wouldn't replace Blackbeard. But that was because he was such a great pirate that they would have voted for him anyway. So, yeah, if you weren't a successful pirate captain, the crew would take a vote and you would have been replaced. And that doesn't mean that you were, you know, thrown off the ship in disgrace. No, you would just become a normal sailor again and someone else would take your place as captain. And you would go around your business again. The captain was just the democratically voted leader of a pirate crew. And at the time, that was something almost revolutionary, because on military ships and merchant ships, there was a strict hierarchy. Pirates, when they say, hey, we live free, this is what they mean. They lived in a democratic state. Most of the pirate laws, even when different crews were interacting with one another, they were all democratically decided. Like, if you have, like, the Pirates of the Caribbean movie, where you have, like, the Council of Pirates, and the Pirate Council, that make the large book, and the rules, pirate rules, it's more like guidelines. Well, that's basically it. Like, a pirate council would democratically vote on these rules, these codes, these agreements, and yeah, then most of them would actually follow them, unless, of course, their specific rule on their ship supersedes the general rule. Like, specific beats general. That's always the case with any rule, every law. But yeah, those things actually kind of were there. But none of those pirates were above the other ones. They were all representatives of their crew. Those on a council, when they were in a pirate haven, they were representing their entire crew. They weren't there because they were more important than someone else. No, they were there because they could embody the needs of their crew better than anyone else. So, again, pirates, these criminals, were pretty progressive in that point. And take into account what I said earlier, most of the time pirates weren't killing anyone. They wanted to prevent bloodshed because bloodshed goes both ways. If you shoot a hole in their ship, they're gonna shoot a hole in your ship. So it's better to scare them into surrender than actually fight and possibly die. So if you hear all of this, you start to realize, like, hey, those were just bullies. But they were really smart people as well. They just bullied people into giving them everything they wanted, and then they lived their days being absolutely free in the Caribbean. So yeah. Now, I have many more stuff I can talk about. I have more a campaign, of course. But I think I'm gonna close it up for tonight. I know I haven't painted a lot, but I'm in no rush. We have some more time we can kill. So, if you guys have any more questions regarding pirates, if you have stories about pirates, if you have certain pirates you want to have a deeper dive, do you have a general idea of how the final will look like? Yeah, sure. It will look like, so this guy is running away from this woman who is chasing him. Excellent stream. Thank you very much, Invisible. So it's a little diorama. It's a bit of a story. It's like just a moment's capture of one pirate going after another one. Maybe because they're from rival crews. Maybe because the dude with the chest has taken part of the loot that wasn't his. Maybe she is just stealing from thieves. Who knows? We don't know. Make up your own mind. That's why the little dioramas exist. I think I'm gonna do more of those dioramas, because I really have a lot of miniatures that, or models that do tell a story if you can put them together a bit. I also have a lot of like furniture, stuff that I can make backgrounds with. So probably gonna do that more often. But I wanted to do this one because it really ties in well with the pirate theme of the stereotypical treasure hunter, swashbuckling scallywags. Now, again, if you guys want me to cover specific pirates, head on down to the Discord and just join the channel. Tell me what you want to hear, tell me what you want to see, and I can do a deep dive next time. Like I said, I still have some other things I can talk about, so don't worry, I'm not going to run out of lore anytime soon. That is why we're here, for the lore, the stories. And I'll be painting these miniatures further next week, Thursday at 8. In the meantime, for those of you who have noticed, I have been playing Baldur's Gate 3 on the stream as well. I am planning to continue doing that. So I really like the game stream as well. I do want to say this is still an exception. I'm not planning on making game streams a part of my mainstay. I'm still primarily painting miniatures, talking lore, wherever I go. But because it's Baldur's Gate, it's D&D, and I really love D&D, I'm making an exception for Baldur's Gate. So, now, if you want, you can also follow me on Instagram. So if you head down there, you can see more pictures. You can see the announcements for upcoming streams, upcoming projects. Maybe even partake in the polls to decide what new team we're going to do. Sometimes I just ask, hey, I have these four options. Tell me what you want to see, and you can decide with me. And if you want to go back to some of my previous streams, you can go visit my YouTube channel. I'm going to try and upload as much of the streams there as possible to just have like a backlog, an archive, as it were. But you can also go there to hear my reading of The Call of Cthulhu that I did a couple of weeks ago, which has been edited down into a audiobook form. It's still rather rough, but, you know, I've noticed that it's getting a lot of traction down there on YouTube, and I'm really impressed by it, so apparently people really like listening to stuff like that. So, call me pleasantly surprised. That's it, guys. I hope you had fun. I am glad that I could have talked about pirates, because it might not have been like an IP, an intellectual property like D&D, Warhammer, stuff like that. Color me surprised. Yes. But yeah, it's still awesome. It's still awesome because it's such a rich tapestry. I have thought about playing a role-playing game set in a pirate setting multiple times already. That being said, I've also played with the idea of putting a role-playing game in the Sengoku era in Japan a couple of times. So after I've done this historical setting, that might actually be something that I'm willing to dive into as well. Because the Sengoku era and the myths and monsters that Japan has are also very interesting. But that is something for way down the line. I have many more projects I'd like to get into, many more models I'm gonna print, many more models I'm gonna paint, and I'm looking forward to sharing that with all of you. Now, for tonight, I'm signing off. I was Christoph. Well, I'm still M. Christoph, but I am Christoph. This was Miniature Mifos, and I hope to see you guys next time. Good night.